All right, folks. So I guess it's a good time to actually start my panel. So first of all, I would like to thank all of you for actually coming here and actually watching my panel. So that's quite a lot of fun. Hope I will answer a lot of your questions, being able to inform a lot of you guys, and maybe even inspire you guys to do some stuff for your own, because I will be talking about YouTubing involving Minecraft. So quickly, just another test. I hope all of you guys can hear me properly right now. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah, we hear you.
All right, awesome. So let me quickly run through what I will be talking about today. So of course, first of all, I will be talking a little bit as an introduction, talking about who I am, what I do, how I got started. The things that I am usually involved with, not just now, but also in the past 5 years that I've been playing Minecraft and being in the community and in general. And of course, the general stuff that I will be talking about today, which is, well, what I'm doing right now. Then afterwards, or after that, I will be talking about some general, more general stuff involving what you need for YouTube. So, that being both the very basic, intermediate, and the very expert requirements, all the way from those people that start playing, what you do when you just want to make a YouTube account, all the way up to those people that actually make a living out of it. So that's pretty cool. I will also be talking about a lot of common mistakes that people make, and what you can do to prevent doing those things. And then in the end, I will be having another question round, and of course, some shameless self-advertising, as you can already see right here, my name. Be sure to check that out. So yes, let's get started. So introduction. Who am I? My name is Kriyanchi. Most people call me Korch because my name is kind of hard to pronounce in the English language. And I've been doing Minecraft for almost 5 years now, 6 years I think I would call it, and making videos of it for 5 years. I started, early 2010, I would say, where I pretty much got the idea of, like, I started playing, I believe it was beta 1.2, something like that. Everyone starts the general old way, punching wood, making a cave and tree, all that kind of basic stuff. But I was always more of that kind of person that was interested in making contraptions with redstone, because redstone was still, very early in that game, wasn't added that long yet. Things like comparators and repeaters weren't really a thing yet either. And stuff like very basic redstone gates were just, very awesome, and you can make some very cool things for that. So that was one of the actual first videos that I actually made, which was in a test world where I made one of those little rapid dispenser thingies. I'm not sure if you guys remember those. Pretty much like you require 4 redstone torches and a bit of redstone in between them, making them tick very fast, connecting them up to a dispenser and making them shoot arrows very fast. Believe it or not, like right now you would say like, okay, what's interesting about that? But just think back like 5 years ago when it was like redstone wasn't even a thing yet, and even just general Minecraft wasn't a thing yet. So that's pretty much where I got started with my first ever video, because I thought like, might as well, record something. Never done anything like that before, but it does seem pretty awesome. So yeah, that's in my opinion pretty cool. Of course, it was pretty crappy, as you can imagine. It had things like big watermarks on top of it. It wasn't edited in any way. It was not just the actual game, but like my entire screen recorded on a pretty crappy desktop computer, like one of those office thingies. So yeah, not that great. But of course, you have to start somewhere, and that was a great start for me. So yes, that was over 5 years ago. Wasn't doing anything big anyway back in that time, just some random messing around in Minecraft. Wasn't part of any community or whatsoever. So, the more I started playing, I also got into a couple of vanilla Minecraft servers because, beta 1.2 mods didn't even exist yet. Forge was still very far in the future. So, yeah, that's pretty cool. So, once I started on that little Minecraft server, we managed to do a lot of cool things together, like make a lot of cool contraptions and all that kind of cool stuff. So I thought, well, I did make a couple of videos before, but I didn't really bother, like, it's worth recording, I didn't really do anything else than that. So I thought, like, maybe I can also record some cool things that we did on that server. And that really caught on, because instead of just a normal Let's Play, people really enjoyed me making little projects and tutorials of that kind of stuff. So that is pretty cool. Sorry, Dangrunners, I'm not able to actually show one of my videos in-game that requires a lot more preparation of those who are actually more experienced with open computers, so I'm sorry, not able to do that. But you can, of course, check it out yourself. I will quickly type the link out in the description so you can check out my channel and just scroll back to see one of my videos. There we go. And I see more and more people are starting to come in. Pretty awesome. So yes, if you want to check out that link that I just posted, you can, you know, scroll back to one of my old videos and be like, wow, is that seriously how you got started? Yes, that's how I got started. And most likely everyone back in those days did, even though big Minecraft YouTubers weren't even a thing yet. Pretty cool. So I will, you know, let you guys rest for just half a minute. Yes, Eagle, I did vanilla, believe it or not. Even though I'm like a massive modded Minecraft fan, back in those days I did vanilla Minecraft. I know, it's collateral, like, what is that? So, yeah. Let me continue with my actual panel now. Hope you guys checked it out. So, like I said, I started doing a couple of, you know, very basic videos on that vanilla server that I played. And in the meantime, I started to look at the options of recording. I believe I was using some sort of version of Bandicam back in those days. Something, I started playing Minecraft in beta 1.2, Somnia Stellarum. I think I mentioned that, but yeah, beta 1.2. Pretty cool. So yes, like I said, I started playing on that server, got myself some very basic recording software, wasn't anything good, but I wanted to improve the content that I made. So I started looking into my other options. Not just recording, but also, you know, maybe some very basic editing, because, you know, not many people, or I wasn't very experienced back then on what you need to do with recording, because I started playing Minecraft when I was 12, 13 years old. Yep, currently 18, so 6 years ago, think back, I was 12, not very experienced people, there wasn't really anything big out there yet, so yeah, had to do with what I can do. So I believe I started playing with the recording software Camtasia. Camtasia was, and still is, a running software that is able to record any specific area on your monitor, and has some very basic editing options. Things like annotations on the actual video, very basic introduction, and also, yeah, audio editing. It's pretty cool. Linux? No, I don't use Linux. Windows only. So yeah, this was pretty awesome. I didn't make any use of a microphone or anything yet back in those days. All I really did was just record the actual gameplay at some very, you know, old school basic YouTube songs on it, like those very old songs that, you know, that basically YouTube already offers for free, no copyright, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, pretty cool, and a couple of annotations pretty much explaining what I did. And you know, the more I started doing those videos, the more I actually enjoyed it doing it myself. And then, well, people seemed to actually watch it, because my subscriber base was growing, the viewers that I got on my videos were growing, and it was just a lot of fun. So after that, I pretty much thought, like, what could be the next major step in my career? And I was thinking, like, maybe I can do some sort of actual Let's Plays, but you know, who would like to watch a Let's Play that doesn't have any people that actually talk in the video, but only use annotations? I mean, that's, yeah, I'm not sure about you, but I wouldn't watch that. Would you? No? Any of you? Nope. Nope. So, yeah, so that's what I did. I believe it was like 3 years ago, so keep in mind that over the first 2 years of that YouTube career, I didn't do anything involving a microphone, just very basic music and annotations. But I thought, yeah, let's get a microphone. So that's what I did. But keep in mind, if you have not done something or done something for a specific way for 2 years, it's very hard to change that. Because, you know, you get into a sort of rhythm and you know what you do and you get comfortable with it. But whenever you change that up, it's kind of difficult. And especially, you know, you don't do that much stuff back in those days yet. This is not the actual same microphone right now. I'm currently using a microphone with a headset just for the ease of speaking and so I don't have that massive microphone in front of my head. But I do indeed use the same microphone as I did 3 years ago, just a Fame CU1, a little bit more of a German microphone. But it's like one of those professional studio microphones, really good quality in my opinion. It's not like Blue Yetis or something like that, but still very high tier recording microphone, so it's pretty awesome. And yeah, I was like, okay, that is pretty awesome. I'm now able to, you know, do what I love, playing Minecraft, make some videos out of it. I started with a very basic subscriber base, so I started getting more comments and more feedback already. And, you know, I can actually do commentaries right now. Because that was also growing more and more, not just, you know, normal game commentaries, but also like live commentaries, unboxings, podcasts, all that kind of cool stuff. So yeah, that's pretty much where I got started back then. But I was still stuck with that little recording program Camtasia. And I mean, it was alright, but it doesn't really offer any configurability in any shape or form. Because pretty much all you can do with it is, you can specify the area that you want to record and the specific audio inputs and outputs. So all I could really do is, you know, select the game and record the audio. Record the audio and video. And that's not really that good. So I started looking into more game-specific recording software. And back in the day, Fraps was starting to come out. I'm fairly sure that most of you guys heard about it already. That program. Pretty much Fraps is a software that focuses on your game only, so you can be, you know, in a different tab, but it will still only record your game. And that already had a bit more options, as in like indicators showing you your frame rates, specific recording frame rates, so either 60 or 30 frames per second, even though back in those days 60 frames per second YouTube wasn't even a thing yet. But still, it felt like I can do a lot more because I have a lot more options that I can change and make it more, you know, more the way I would like to record and make my content. Because that's, in my opinion, one of the most important things in YouTube in general, making the content yours. It's something you do, you should be proud of, and you share to the world. Not something, you know, you just do because someone else likes it, but you should just, you know, like it yourself too. And that's pretty awesome in my opinion. So, yeah, I believe I've used that program for around a year or so. I think I did. I was still kind of in the middle, like, okay, I'm recording with Fraps and rendering with Camtasia. But I wanted to do more in my videos, not just the very basic annotations that I was able to do in Camtasia, but also things like maybe transitions, better overlays, pictures, green screen effects, all that kind of stuff. So that's what I decided to make quite a big step from Camtasia to Sony Vegas Pro, which is still the same software that I use today. There we go, that name. That is pretty cool. For those interested, by the way, into the settings that I use for recording right now, you can check them out on my website. I have all the specific settings listed right there, because I will be talking about like all the general things that I use, but the very specific software for those that want to record themselves can check it out on my website. Pretty cool. Which is... that, by the way. Just making sure you guys all know that. Then I was using Fraps and Sony Vegas Pro, which already made it possible for me to get some very good content out there. I was able to edit most of the stuff out that I didn't like. I was making cool transitions between my videos. I already had a pretty good microphone, so you know, my commentaries were getting better, and yeah, it was starting to get a lot more fun. But in the meantime, when all of that stuff happened, I started playing with some very basic Minecraft mods, which goes back just a little bit more again, because when I started playing Minecraft mods, I believe it was beta 1.4 or beta 1.5, like those good old days where you can only mess with Industrial Craft, Build Craft, and you know, Red Power combined with you know, the Too Many Items mod. Like, Not Enough Items wasn't even a thing yet. Forge wasn't even a thing yet. You just had to use let's see, what did you actually use again? Mod Loader, that's the one, because Forge didn't even exist yet. And all just some very basic mods that altered the game, you know, just slightly, like single player commands and all that kind of stuff, that you, some of you most likely won't even remember that, but that's like the old school modded Minecraft days, so that's absolutely awesome in my opinion. So yeah, meanwhile, while my YouTube career was, well, I keep calling it a career, but it's pretty much something I do as a hobby, so it's partially a career, but still, at the same time, I don't do it for a living, so just keep that in mind for you guys. So yeah, so I was getting better software, better recording, hardware too, and at the same time, I started playing more Minecraft mods. And something that I really like doing, and I still like doing, believe it or not, is making little contraptions with mods. They don't always have to be like extremely difficult, but just little tiny setups using two or more different types of mods that allow you to, you know, make something cool. Like just randomly thinking of some old school videos that I made were like a little contraption where you automatically duplicate blaze rods using, I believe it was Industrial Craft 1 and Equivalent Exchange 1. So it's like old school modded Minecraft duplication glitches and abusive stuff. So that's so cool to actually do. And I was like, wow, this actually works, and I'm fairly certain people will actually like to, you know, use this too in their world. So I started recording more of those projects, and what do you know, people actually liked them, and they started catching on, and I was getting more and more views, subscribers, and feedback on that stuff. So that is, you know, more motivation for me to actually get my videos out. Because, of course, one of the main reasons, of course, is that you should like doing it yourself. But if you can get support from the outside, it's even better, of course. Blaze rods, weren't they introduced? I'm not sure exactly. I might be wrong on a couple of dates, but I am thinking just back on, you know, a couple of old stuff. But you might be right. I'm not exactly sure when the exact dates of modded Minecraft or vanilla Minecraft stuff was added. Sorry. So yeah, let's see. What else happened? Oh yeah, right. So we are currently, I believe, like 3 years out of the 5 years in, so think back 2 years. So I was still, you know, growing strong, making awesome content that I loved, but then all of a sudden I got contacted by a partnering company. And believe, like, back in those days, 2 or 3 years ago, I keep saying it like back in those days, like it was like 20 years ago, but like, I was still more of a kid than I currently am. And I was like, okay, it's a fun hobby, but apparently there's a way that you can actually make money with this. Like, I never even considered it, thought it was something that was possible, and even my parents were kind of skeptical, which they actually should be. Like, okay, this is kind of a big deal, because people wanted to, you know, actually partner you with like a contract and everything, to put advertisements on your videos. I'm currently partnered by the same company that I actually accepted back in those days, which is Maker Studios, through the partnering company N4GTV. So yeah, right there. And well, yeah, I had to do a lot of thinking if that was worth it, because, you know, it was always something I did myself. The entire YouTube thing, making videos and all of it, and now some outside company wanted to step in and help me out with a lot of different things at once. Because most major partnering companies, like Maker Studios, which is one of the biggest ones on YouTube out there, have quite a big base on ways that they are able to help you. Not just, you know, paying very, you know, paying you for actually making the videos and putting them out there, but also just things like non-copyright music, helping you when you actually get copyright, so they were able to get rid of that. They know a lot of connections within the YouTube community, and they of course have a lot of experience, so they can give you tips on what you need to do to actually, you know, be able to grow yourself. And they had some very useful tips on what people generally like to see and things that you can change on your channel. So, yeah, that's definitely something that I was considering. Keep in mind, like, I was still, you know, I haven't signed anything yet, but I was still just thinking of the pros and cons and if it was worth it and not a scam or anything like that. So, I did some major research into not only the partnering company itself, but also the all the people behind it. And also talking to a lot of other YouTubers that were not only partnered by them, but also just partnered in general by other companies. And, you know, they were, most of the people were very positive about it. Like, they experienced massive growth ever since that happened. You know, a lot of cool stuff. And that's pretty much what convinced me, like, okay, this is something I would like to do, as I have been doing YouTube for 3 years back then. And I would hope to do it even longer. So, yes, let's do it. So, yeah, there I was, this very basic newbie Dutch person, 15 years old, partnered by a very big YouTube company, making Minecraft videos. So, that's pretty much where the massive growth of my channel happened. So, because I started doing more modded Minecraft, and that's where some of you guys may know me from too, not just from my YouTube channel or just, you know, being random people that watch my panel right now, but also, you know me from modded Minecraft in general, is that, you might know, is that I'm involved in a lot of modded Minecraft, modded Minecraft events. So, most people would say I'm a jack of all trades when it involves Minecraft, as in the 3 years that I, or 3-4 years that I've been doing modded Minecraft, I have met so many people and talked to them, let them know their experiences, learned from them, that I got inspired to do a lot of that stuff myself. So that's where I, you know, done a lot of things as a side, well, I almost want to call it a side job, but it's like a side hobby. Around actually playing Minecraft and making YouTube videos. Mainly being, I've worked for the Resonant Rise 3 modpack on the AT launcher, where I've been, I believe it's like 2.5 years now, I made or helped it grow as a community person, mainly being one of the bigger folks that helped communicate the community, like you guys, with the actual developers of the modpack, and making some actual videos on that modpack, which was a lot of fun too. Met some awesome people right there already, connections, always good. Started messing around with IRC, never heard of it before before that time, but you know, it's another great way to stay in touch with the community, and that's definitely something that I love to do. So, yeah. Alright, let's see.
May I cut in?
Sure.
There's a public service announcement. The there's a crash currently going on for a client crash. So be careful when you move out the panel room that you're in. If you go too far, you might crash as well and not be able to rejoin until it's fixed. So just letting you guys know.
Oh wow. Yeah. Then be sure to stay here. Don't leave. So, yeah, that's already pretty awesome in my opinion. So, I started talking to more people on IRC. Through modded Minecraft, I started talking to more and more actual mod developers. Pretty much thinking like, okay, you're able to actually add content to a pre-existing game. How on earth does that work? And I was already extremely fascinated because I'm one of those people that, I've been playing sandbox games ever since I can remember. like before Minecraft even, I always played sandbox games because it allows you to be creative and make your own worlds, for example. And especially even with Minecraft code, it allows you to do it on a lot more advanced step. So that's what I started doing too, as a little bit of a side hobby, which is, you know, thinking, how can I possibly mod Minecraft myself? Sadly, you know, due to my lack of Java knowledge, I didn't really get that far back in the time. But then the Computer Craft mod came around. And of course Open Computers, but that's still something I have to learn. And I was like, this is like a big stepping stone in between, you know, normal Minecraft and actually coding Minecraft, which is, well, Computer Craft coding in Minecraft. So that's where I pretty much started learning Lua, which is a lot easier than Java, just very toned down and everything. So that's something I really enjoyed, and because of mainly, or not mainly, but also because of that step, I pretty much considered like, okay, I'm enjoying this much, I really hope I'm able to actually do something with this later. And, you know, it's always fun if you are able to make your job out of a hobby, of course, in any shape, way or form. So that's pretty much what I started doing. I started investigating more and more into what I'm actually able to do with the passion to code and, you know, bring out the ideas that you have to be able to change something or make something out of nothing. And that's also what I'm doing right now. I'm a first year software engineering student, so that's a lot of fun. One of the top of my class at this moment, and just enjoying it a lot. Yeah, and that's in Java, by the way. So there comes my past back to haunt me. Started when I wanted to make Minecraft mods without any Java knowledge and sucked at it, all the way to actually learning Java through a professional school right now. So that's pretty cool. I'm doing it in the Avent University of Applied Sciences in the Netherlands. Just so you guys are interested, one of the highest rated schools in the actual Netherlands, so that's a lot of fun. So that's the modded aspect of YouTube. But then, you know, like I said, I've done a lot of different things too. Like, not just actual playing with mods, but also thinking of, well, am I able to actually put a mod pack together myself? Because the first time mods were released, they weren't in a mod pack or something. They were just separate files that you had to download, open with WinRAR and all that kind of stuff, edit Java files, drop the contents in, crash 3 gazillion times, because of course there weren't any proper crash logs, and you know, Forge wasn't anything. Oh yeah, right, Eagle, deleting meta-inf, all that stuff, people keep forgetting that so many times back in those days, even I, it was so fun, just even thinking back, like, how much trouble we had to go for to even be able to play with a couple of mods. And, you know, I definitely enjoyed doing that too, because I mainly played with them myself, and then, well, yeah, playing with them myself, making the Minecraft videos out of them. So I thought, well, maybe it would be cool to actually start my own modpack, which is what I did for a short term, which was the Kingdom of the Creeper modpack, which is a lot of fun, actually, being able to make a modpack and watch other people play it. So that's, yeah, just a lot of fun, too. Let's see, what else did I do back in those days? I was pretty much at this time, again, playing Resonant Rise. At the same time when I started, like, okay, I messed around with some basic mod making, didn't really work out that well, and I did play with a custom mod pack, which I made myself again. So that was pretty cool. But there's a lot more that I am able to do. So instead of just making the actual content for my videos too, like editing and such, I started thinking, like, would it be possible if I would get into the more better art for my videos? So that's what I also did a lot of learning in and about. Pretty much seeing, like, what do most people do to make some proper, you know, overlays and such in their videos. So I started to mess around with Photoshop a lot more, seeing what I'm actually able to do making things like fancy shaders in my videos, and you know, one of those things that you might be able to see in some videos, like they pop up saying, you know, this is my Twitter account, subscribe here or follow or that kind of stuff. So yeah, I started making more and more of that stuff, again learning more and more through my experiences, failing a lot, but also learning a lot from that process. So that is, again, I just keep saying this, but it's a lot of fun to actually do and experience yourself, believe it or not, because you learn from your mistakes, especially involving gaming. But mainly because it is gaming, it doesn't really matter that much if you fail, because it's a game and you can always try again. And that's really one of the things that also inspired me to actually play sandbox games, because you're, you know, if you do something wrong, break it or rebuild it or fix it or, you know, do whatever you would like to do. And yeah, that's just a huge motivational boost if you want to do that kind of stuff. So that's so pretty awesome. So yeah, I guess, let's see. So we've been like talking about the past 3 years. So let me quickly talk about what stage I am currently at. I'm pretty sure most of you guys will be able to, you know, think of some sort of bridge between that and right now. So I am still using Sony Vegas, as that is still a very good editing software in my opinion. But instead of Fraps, I switched to DX Story. That program. DX Story has some very basic key functionality like Fraps. Like it has a little overlay that you see in Fraps in the top left corner most of the time, showing your frame rate and such. And you know, it automatically locks onto your game and everything. But DX Story has a lot more options. Things like built-in screenshot functionality. It allows you to change your recording codec. Separate audio lines, which is a huge help, believe it or not, being able to split your microphone and your headphone or your speakers in separate audio lines, especially when editing, because instead of, you know, having to edit very difficultly, trying to separate it yourself, believe it, like, or think about, like, how would you call it? Like, you know, very loud in-game sounds, making you almost not able to actually hear your microphone. If you record in separate audio lines, it allows you to change them independently from each other, so you can, you know, turn down your game sounds a bit, turn up your volume, so people can watch it a lot better. And that's one of the big reasons that I switched to DX Story. Just that stuff. Yeah, that's already pretty cool. Let me quickly see what other options it has, because I'm kind of, you know, I don't know everything out of my head, of course. Let's see, one sec, guys. Ah, yes. So, not only is it able to record separate audio lines, but it's also able to actually specify what the specific outputs are. So, both, that's both for audio and video, by the way. As you can record in stereo and mono sound, for example, like loads of different kinds of codecs for audio you can choose, just to get the right quality for your microphone and your content and your game in general. And then also for videos, it allows you to change so much stuff, like the separate frame rate. Let's see, things like automatic screenshots while taking videos, changing the actual thumbnail of the video. Yeah, let's see. Yeah, like file size, the percentage of quality. It just offers so much more functionality than Fraps, in my opinion, and that's why I switched to that. There's only one thing that was, you know, kind of a big issue. As I was still playing with a pretty crappy computer, I was like, okay, this does not really work out that well, because I was having a very low frame rate. The files that were output from the recording software were very high, you know, high size files. Because for the best quality, I like to record uncompressed, as that doesn't compromise my frame rate in-game. Yeah, or the actual quality of the video, but it does mean that an average of, let me do a little bit of a guessing here for you guys. If I record a half an hour video in, 1080p and 60 frames per second, guess what the actual file size is? Okay, some of you guys were kind of close, but not exactly. So, if I record that, the general file size is around 15 gigabytes. Yes, 15 gigabytes per file. So, keep that in mind, that I'm... if you're using a very small computer that only has around 500 gigabytes of hard drive space, that's not a lot. So, that's why I decided that it's time for another major step. I need a better computer, both to get myself a better frame rate and to be able to record more. So that's what I did. As I currently have a 3 terabyte hard drive storage and around 250 gig SSD, so I can record very fast, store very fast, move files around, but also store a lot of content on my actual hard drive in case something goes wrong with the edited files. So that's pretty cool. Yeah, that's pretty much the stage that I am at right now. Through all the time, I also managed to do a lot more side things, being promotion of my actual channel and the content I create, being like my own IRC channel on Espernet. I got myself my own website right there, which also has a lot more information about the videos that I put out, but also the actual settings, like I already mentioned in the beginning of this panel, for those who missed it. Things like, is it on VPS or just a hosting? It's actually the website to me. It's actually hosted professionally. So, pretty cool. So, yeah, that's pretty much the main things that I want to talk about for, that... discuss me. So let's talk a little bit about the requirements that you need to actually record. So I keep saying this over and over to everyone that always asks me, like, okay, I want to record, but what do I need to actually, make a YouTube channel? One thing that I always tell them is stay true to yourself. Do what you love to do and make the videos the way you like them to make. Don't just do it, because, you saw someone else do it and you're like, oh no, I want more views than him. No, don't do that. That doesn't work. Also, being someone else in your videos than you are in real life, like, if you're a very funny guy in real life but try to be like very sad in your videos, that generally doesn't really work out that well. So that's something you really shouldn't do. If you want to make videos yourself, stay true to yourself and just have a lot of fun. Then, of course, is some ideas. You want to be able to record something that you do. So, in my opinion, or in my case, that was very basic Minecraft projects and contraptions that I made. But it can vary by person, because instead of just play Minecraft, you can do like Call of Duty or FIFA or, not even gaming, like unboxings or podcasts or that kind of cool stuff. So that's a lot of fun. Of course, you need a decent computer too. At least to get started. Of course, there's a very big curve on what you actually need to record, because you're able to record with like 15 frames per second, but usually that doesn't mean the content is that easy to watch, all the way up to around, a general stable 60 frames per second, which is the most comfortable to watch. So that is something you want to keep in mind if you want to do it yourself. And that's pretty much all you need to actually start making YouTube videos. Of course, with a YouTube channel that is. Then there are a bit more intermediate options, which is, of course, a better computer, possible software that you can make art with yourself, very basic editing software to actually, change the quality of your videos up a little bit and be able to add more stuff to your videos, and a microphone in my case, or either a good microphone too. So, that's pretty much the intermediate requirements, in my opinion. And then, of course, the more expert requirements are, of course, you know, a beast, $3,000 computer, beast things with a quad GPU, GTX Titan thing, whatever. professional microphones, of course, and possibly a webcam, because that's what most high-end YouTubers do too. When they want to get more personal with the videos, is use a webcam, so they actually show them gaming while they actually do it. Pretty cool. So, in the modded Minecraft, or just, you know, the basic YouTube community, there are a lot of different playstyles, and it's really important that you find one that fits your own. Being either tutorials, playthroughs, showcases, reveals and unboxings, vlogs, podcasts, all that kind of stuff. And yeah, that's, you know, it's progress of falling and standing up. Because, you know, you don't really know what you like unless you try it out yourself, especially with that kind of stuff. So that is something I would really recommend you guys trying if you are into actually starting a YouTube channel myself or yourself. So yeah, I wish you all the best of luck with that if you are interested in that. So then there are a couple of common mistakes that I would like to talk to you guys about. This is something, you know, a lot of people do wrong usually, and just if you want to make some videos, just keep a couple of these things in mind, because they might be able to help you get your content out better. So first of all is rushing through your content. Of course, it's good if you want to show your content to people, but it's, you know, they still want to be entertained when they watch it. It's not really fun if you just rush through everything you did, say, or miss like half of the content you originally wanted to talk about, and then realize like, okay, this doesn't really work out at all. It's also kind of important to actually prepare what you want to say. I don't mean it in a way like write down an entire script, but you know, do think a little bit ahead of time, like, okay, this is how I want to start my video out a bit. I usually want to end with that thing, and you know, in general, I want to do this in my video. And that already helps out a lot, as you have some general guidelines of what you can hold yourself onto when playing. Then, you know, something most of you guys have already know, you know, or seen, you know, those old school videos that have like that crappy music in the background that use Notepad in the actual video to talk to you guys and don't do anything else. Yeah, don't be that guy. Just don't. You don't want that. Be sure to check out, be sure to double check if you're using songs in your videos that it isn't copyrighted songs, because, you know, even if you have 200 videos and you manage to get yourself a couple of videos with copyright strikes, YouTube has the right to shut down your channel. And that is definitely something you don't want, because that means all your work is wasted. So make sure you don't use copyrighted songs, or at least have permission to use them. And then, of course, for actual, you know, audio perspective of the videos, double check the audio levels before recording and also when editing them. So make sure they are able to actually hear you when recording. Make sure the in-game audio or your microphone isn't too loud. And, you know, it's just a pleasant level to watch, because you don't want people screaming in your head because, well, you know, their ears start bleeding and all that stuff. Not something you want. So yes, that is the main stuff that I wanted to talk about today. I went through it a little bit faster than I thought, but I hope you guys have a lot of questions so we can fill in the rest of that time. So if you guys have any questions, feel free to let me know down right now. I will try to answer them as much as possible and in a most precise way as possible. Have I had copyright issues before, and what do you think of YouTube song removal? I did have a couple of copyright songs in the past, but that was really on very old videos where I didn't really care about copyright at all and didn't even know it was a thing yet. So where I just, you know, I like this song, let's put it under there. Yeah, that's not something you want. And that is indeed when the song got removed from YouTube, instead of actually having the issue of the entire video being banned or, you know, having issues with my channel. Luckily, I just had the chance to remove the song and everything was okay again. So, yeah, pretty cool. What are those things on my feet? These are hover boots. from Open Computers. Ooh, Vextos, that is a difficult question. I'd say a chicken-sized Fragrum. Have I ever had problems with time for editing or recording? I guess it's kind of easy to believe that I definitely had some issues with that. Especially because I'm a full-time student with a weekend job and not a very steady schedule with school times and projects. It's not that hard to believe that I did have a lot of issues in the past and still have sometimes when I actually want to record or edit videos, especially if stuff goes wrong, both editing-wise or in the video, like not what I planned. And I'm like, okay, I have 2 hours to record something, and it turns out I need a lot more because stuff in-game just doesn't work the same way I originally thought it would. It's kind of annoying, but it's just something you have to work around with, and, sometimes that just means that you can't exactly follow the schedule that you originally intended, which is a shame, but, there are worse things in life, and at least you still manage to get the content out that you want, maybe not in time, or the same time that you normally wanted, but you do. Do you ever use open source music sites for your video? I do actually. Through my partnership, through Maker Studios, I'm able to get myself access to a huge database of copyright-free music. Only the actual partner, so I'm not able to share it with you guys, sorry. But it allows me to get a lot of sound effects, actual music on my videos, but also, not through my actual partnership, but through actual other music record labels, like, do you guys know Monster Cat? Do you guys know the company? Yeah, like, I'm allowed to use their music on my videos. There are pretty much 3 steps of copyright. One, you were able to use their songs, and they get banned because you're not allowed to use them. 2 is they're, you're allowed to use them, but they get monetized by them. And the 3rd step is pretty much where you have to pay to use their music, and you actually get paid, the general way you usually would. And then pretty much that 2nd step. So I'm allowed to use their music and all that stuff, but they do get monetized to their company. So that's pretty cool. Is this a silly and unrelated question? Yes, Vexitos.
Silly and unrelated questions? Didn't miss much then.
Not really.
Yeah. Also, where's that idiot that killed me with something?
I have no idea.
Well, someone has a weapon that kills creative players and killed me and crashed me.
Oh, wow. So, do any of you guys have any more questions?
Actually, for those that couldn't hear me because they're using precision audio, the server's safe again.
Woohoo.
Yeah, I'm back. There was something near spawn that was crashing and someone killed people while we all got kicked out and crashed.
What do you think of Open Computers? Pretty cool, but I have yet had the chance to mess with them, so I'm definitely hoping I'm able to use them a lot more. Do you have
I think they're more realistic than computer craft, but they're harder to set up.
Yeah, precisely. Do I have any pets, and if you do, do they ever cause noise in your video? I do have 1 dog, but that's like 1 very tiny little animal that doesn't bark at all or something. So for me, that's not something I ever had any issues with in my actual videos. What were the best resources you used to learn about YouTubing? I would just say experience. Learn from the mistakes that you make yourself and, see what you can do after that. When did you start scheduling your videos? Well, I started scheduling my videos at the time where I considered that when I started doing YouTube Let's Plays, it was better for me to upload them at a specific time every other day or 3 days, something like that. That's the moment where I realized, like, okay, people like to have a more steady schedule of watching videos, so that's a good time to actually, you know, change it up instead of uploading and putting it to public, to actually, you know, maybe wait a day and setting it to go live at a specific time. Now that I'm studying software creation, do you still use Lua a lot? For my actual study, I don't use Lua at all, but you know, if I ever want to make something using computer crafts, of course I do use Lua because it's a, you know, the main language used in computer crafts, so that's a lot of fun. How do I feel about 30-second dubstep intros with lots of CGI followed by potato quality video? MLG? Yeah. I don't really think that's a question worth answering because I guess you can do it yourself. What content do you watch on YouTube? There's a lot of different stuff that I actually watch on YouTube, Eagle. Mainly, you know, of course, Minecraft Let's Plays and also Hearthstone, something I definitely enjoy playing too. But also things like tech channels, like Linus Tech Tips and all that stuff. Definitely some channels that I enjoy doing. Wow, AZ, that's... wow. Open computers or computer craft? At this point, I will have to say computer craft because I have not messed with open computers at all, really. Besides, of course, the screen behind me. But I'm definitely considering, you know, trying open computers out. Have I ever gotten into PvP? Yes, I do, actually. I used to play on a PvP server, too. It was a lot of fun to do. Most of the time we were good friends and all, but it's always fun to have a bit of riot in your game to spice things up a bit. Lots of fun. No furry propaganda, fuck squad. Snagar, definitely, I really want to check that out too, same with open computers. Pretty much all the mods that are on Minecon this year, I would definitely like to try out and see, you know, what they can do. Pretty cool. Any more questions? I have never messed with Computronics before? I'm not sure. I can't remember. Don't think so. What's next for your channel? Eagle, you know that. I'm not allowed to spoil that yet. But it will involve some modded Minecraft stuff. Ooh, what's my favorite mod? That's an annoying question to answer. Honestly, I'm not really sure what my favorite mod is. It used to be Industrial Craft for a long time, but honestly, I don't really know. A rainbow one? Go ahead, AZ. AZ, go ahead. Shh.
All right, so since you mentioned that you're going to do something involving modded Minecraft recently, right?
Yes.
So it is our VTM tradition to upgrade your modded Minecraft activities to Minecraft 1.8. There we go, upgraded.
Yep.
Now you can play on Minecraft 1.8 with us.
Woo!
Yep, that's 1.8 development right there.
Thank right, you. Sorry for an interruption.
So, yeah. Any more questions?
Yeah, why are you hiding behind barriers?
Because of you guys and your tomatoes.
Those tomatoes are in trouble. not very far.
It doesn't work.
We can throw them, but not very far. We can't get them on the stage, really.
What do I think of the no GUI fat thing that's going on the mods?
Use the dirt bombs.
I mean, some mods are pretty cool without GUIs, like Batania, but in my opinion, for some mods, they just work better if they do have a GUI. So, no, personal choice.
Well, you're cleaning that up yourself.
Well, this is a dirty situation.
Wow. I have no idea what the mind
just
camera mod
bit.
Is, actually, Rushmeat. But I did mess around with Camera Studios a lot before, making smooth time lapses and all that stuff. So that's a lot of fun too. Anymore? Oh, I definitely have seen the replay mod. Fairly excited about that, actually, as it allows you to, you know, play Minecraft without any compromises and still be able to record and edit it later on. Dangranos, I absolutely love that feature, being able to play videos in-game. Because, well, if you don't, you're crazy. Any more? No? No more questions? Then I would hereby like to officially end my panel right here. Definitely want to thank you guys for actually being here and listening to my random gibberish about my YouTube career, complaining and, you know, trying to help you guys out. Feel free to ever message me on YouTube, IRC, or any other content source that you can find me with either any questions or, you know, just have a chat. I'd like to talk to you guys about anything and being able to help you guys out if you need any help with that. So it's pretty cool. Again, be sure to check out my website and YouTube. So yeah, I'm going into the shameless self-advertisement mode right here. So be sure to check that out. And you know, yeah, have a lot of fun. Do I make advanced tutorials? Sometimes I do. Depends on the amount of people that request it. I am currently running a high-end logistics pipe tutorial for one Minecraft 1.7.10 tutorial. So that's pretty cool. So yeah, that's it, I guess. Thank you, guys.